Good morning, everybody. I have to say I'm already very inspired to be here, to meet with all the students and to hear the speakers before me. And it's a privilege, and I would like to thank all the students and Amity for giving me this opportunity. So I would like to start by sharing a story that I heard some time back. It's a metaphorical story, and it says that it believes that when we are born, we are all born with, in a metaphorical way, like having a huge palace inside us. And the palace is, if you can imagine, every single trait, every single capability, every single ability that we have, you know. So there is a whole palace that we come with in terms of our attributes and abilities. And as we start growing up, and in as part of our socialization and our the culture within which we grow up, we learn to slowly start closing the windows and doors of the various rooms in this palace. So for example, you grow up to be a girl and you are told girls don't laugh loudly, so one room closes down. You grow up and somebody says, oh, you're looking too fat, another room closes down. You grow up as a Dalit and somebody says, but Dalits are not allowed to do this kind of work, another room closes down. And as we grow up in life, we keep closing down these rooms based on all that we hear about what you should do, what you should not do. What you should do, what you should not do. Is that audible? And trying to, you know, disbelieve in our own abilities and in our own desires. So ultimately, when we grow up, we are basically living in a two-room house as compared to a palace in which we were born in. So breaking barriers for me then is about breaking down these doors that we have closed down on our own selves and learning to open them slowly. And as you move within inside you and open up the various possibilities that exist in you, we see the magic that unfolds. And I think Mr. Ravi Kalra's presentation was all about that, as he opened up the various rooms in his own, in himself. And that's exactly what has been my experience in my life, as I have worked with hundreds and hundreds of women across various states in India and in parts of Africa. And I have seen the magic happen when all these women started believing in themselves and said, yes, we can do, moving from a place in mind of I can't to I can. I think that's the most magical transformation that we can all achieve for ourselves. Currently, I lead this initiative of Women on Wheels, where we work with young, resource-poor women who live in basties and slums in Delhi, Jaipur and Kolkata. And the idea that we work with them is to support them and to help them to empower themselves to become empowered women professional chauffeurs. So they go through a period of training with us, and they acquire licenses, they acquire a whole lot of skills, and they become chauffeurs in terms of, you know, women who drive cars. We have a foundation, Azhar Foundation, which does the training, and we have a company called Sakha, which provides employment options to the women drivers. And we have seen woman after woman who comes into Azhar Foundation basically looking for help to change her life, primarily for a job, and quite not sure that she can do the job of being a driver because she's grown up thinking that that's a man's job. And as she completes the journey, she not only learns to believe that she can do the job of a driver, but she starts to enjoy it. And also, as part of the design of our program, we help her to question that just like women can then do work which is considered to be a man's work in public spaces, so the men can also then begin to do what is considered to be a woman's work inside their homes, you know. So it's like questioning a thought, about gender division of labor, which begins from a public space and then taking it into the household space. Because if you would know, over the last couple of decades, women's participation in workforce has been declining in India. It's one of the few countries where women's work participation in workforce has declined by more than 10 decimal points, and most of the reports and research and studies point out to the same fact. So whether you are a resource poor woman or whether you're a woman belonging to any class, caste or community, the main reasons why you would walk out of the workforce is because you don't have support in terms of taking care of your reproductive responsibilities or your care responsibilities at home. And so this is what we are trying to prove, not just to the women that they can take on responsibilities outside, but also to the rest of the society and how it needs to be done. So we call ourselves a disruptive enterprise, a disruptive social enterprise. We disrupt notions of livelihood, what women can do, what women cannot do, and therefore we promote what we call non-traditional livelihoods for women, particularly resource poor women. We disrupt notions of gender division of work. So if women can take on responsibilities that are considered to be quote-unquote men's responsibilities outside, getting into professions such as driving, plumbers, masons, electricians, etc., etc., then men can also become cooks at home. I know that there are men who are chefs outside, but they can be, you know, they can be taking on responsibility of cooking at home, looking after the children, and and taking on housework as their own work. So we disrupt the notion of gender, the gender division of work, and we disrupt the notions of work also in the marketplace, because majority of the industry works with the principle of contractualization. Entrepreneurship is supposed to be a big word today, but the reality is that resource poor women and most of the people around the world would like basic, you know, basic decent jobs and wages. So we try to so the women who work with Sakha are on salaried basis with Sakha, and you know, with all the social security welfare measures that they need to have, but they have been now working with us for several years. When we started in 2008, I don't think there was a single, there was probably one professional woman driver in Delhi, and today there are nearly 400 to 500 women bus drivers. The first woman bus driver in Delhi's history has been supported by us, who now drives a bus in DTC. There are women drivers in five-star hotels in different parts of the city. And of course, we are a huge population, so it may not be as visible, and we have not really invested so much in our marketing. But the fact is that today the industry itself, like, you know, the Uber or the Ola or Meru's and Easy's, are making statements that they would like to have women drivers. The state governments are committed to it, and the challenge is that they need to understand a little more as to what it takes to bring women into non-traditional livelihoods. It's the same challenge that you find even within the education sector, right? We find very few young girls moving into what are considered STEM fields, you know, science, technology and mathematics, etc., engineering and mathematics. And so the bias gets represented also in the livelihood sector. So basically, I feel that the work that we do is that when women enter Azad, we help them to start opening up the various rooms in their own, in themselves. And so they say, yeah, I can go out, I can be on the road alone, I can drive a car, I can speak in English to a foreign customer, I can say no to violence, I can have my bank account, I can decide how my money is spent. And when those different lamps get switched on, when those different rooms in her house get opened up, she becomes a magnificent woman. The power within reflects then in the power outside. And finally, I would also like to say, it's not possible to help somebody to open these different rooms in their own lives if you have not done it, or if you're not doing it to yourself. And I think for me, I have benefited hugely from this journey that I've had in my life by continuing to face my own fears on a daily basis. You know, how will this happen? How will we be able to do that? And then you realize that once you commit yourself to something, and every time you overcome a challenge, and every time you feel commit yourselves to that feeling of falling free in a gravity-less zone, and then you realize it's not as bad as I thought it's going to be. So that, I think, is really the journey of life. Breaking boundaries, outside while also remembering that the toughest boundaries to break are those that are within us. Thank you very much.